Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Domestic Revolution, How the Introduction of Coal into Victorian Homes Changed Everything, by Ruth Goodman. Narrated by Jennifer M. Dixon. Publisher's note: this audiobook refers to illustrations included in the print and ebook editions of the book. Forward. Lived History. About 10 years ago, for the purpose of making a TV program, I found myself standing in front of a newly refitted coal-fired iron range. It was part of a semi-derelict cottage into which we'd already put a huge amount of work, rebuilding a staircase, replastering walls, renewing windows and doors, and relaying a floor. We then inserted a salvaged range, giving it a thorough overhaul before gently easing it into its new home. Brickwork was adjusted around it, then all the gaps were sealed. We gathered round as the first fire was lit and became a tad overexcited when smoke began issuing from the chimney with barely a wisp visible in the kitchen. The program we were making required me and my two colleagues to run a small farm for a year in the manner typical of British people in the second half of the 19th century. As the woman on the team, and following on from Victorian practice, this black metal box and its dirty black fuel were to be my responsibility. I had never cooked on coal before. I did, however, have a great deal of experience working with wood fires, including for a previous TV series that had run for a year, as well as 20 years' worth of weekends and short breaks in various structures and open spaces. I felt fairly confident that a coal range would be well within my capabilities. Well, I managed it, but the encounter was much more challenging and interesting than I had anticipated, and it was one that encompassed much more than cooking. The radically different practices involved in running a coal-fired home in comparison to running a wood-fired one took me completely by surprise. So many things that I had taken for granted suddenly became immediate and pressing issues. The challenges that I was facing and the adjustments I was having to make as I learnt to deal with coal were wide-reaching. When I considered the impact such changes must have had, when multiplied by the number of households that had made these changes in the past, it was mind-boggling. I began to realise that the usual narratives about the development of the home, the countryside and the modern industrial world were missing something. The big switch to domestic coal in the late 16th and early 17th centuries. In many ways, I was in a highly unusual position. Most people experimenting with the use of coal as a fuel are approaching the problem from a modern perspective, making comparisons with gas and electricity. Our attitudes and assumptions are necessarily backwards-looking. But much of my experience came from older technologies. I have probably cooked more meals over a wood fire than I have over gas or electric cookers. I have certainly cleaned more houses heated by open wood fires than those with central heating, and long ago adapted my laundry regime to something inspired by earlier methods. My engagement with the great outdoors was almost entirely framed by historical experiment and experience, with weekends spent felling trees with axes and cross-cut saws, coppicing patches of woodland, building period styles of fencing and growing heirloom plants. Looking at the world through wood-burning eyes was second nature to me. From this vantage, it was obvious to me that the switch to coal would have had a huge impact on the daily routines of people from all walks of life. I first became aware that some of the practical skills I was learning could genuinely form a useful addition to the scholarly understanding of this history when I was invited to help out some 20 years ago at the Mary Rose Trust. This charity is charged with caring for the archaeological remains of Henry VIII's flagship, which sank as he watched from the shore in the strait between the Isle of Wight and the English mainland on the 19th of July, 1545. The excavation of the flagship's remains had revealed two brick structures sitting upon some loose gravel ballast at the ship's bottom, on either side of a central keel beam. These were assumed to be the galleys. However, when the ship reached the seabed upon that fateful day, nearly 500 years ago, it had tipped over onto one side, sending one of the two galley structures crashing over on top of the other. The excavations had thus mostly uncovered a mass of rubble. The Trust had launched a project to reconstruct the cooking facilities and provide a better picture of life on board a mid-Tudor warship. A great deal of thought and effort went into the work. Bricks, mortar, iron bars, flashings and metal pots were sampled and analysed. Reconstructions were made using techniques and materials that were as close to those available in the original period as possible. Wherever the original form had survived the passage of time, it was closely copied. The structures were square in plan, with an open firebox door on one side, and each held a single large metal pot supported in part by two iron bars. When I saw them, I thought they resembled the laundry coppers common in outhouses in Edwardian days, although they did not have the iron grate and iron door usually found in these more recent domestic conveniences. When all of the building work was completed, I was invited to reconstruct how the cooking structure might have been used. I had at that point about 10 years' experience with 16th-century kitchen equipment, utilising both wood and charcoal, and I had been researching and practising the techniques and recipes of the era. I couldn't wait to get cooking. My first meeting with the project's lead archaeologist was exciting. I learned that not only had the two galley structures survived, albeit in fragmentary form, but so too had an array of cooking vessels and equipment. Barrels with the remains of butchered meat and fish, a scattering of grains, various other plant materials, including whole peppercorns, and perhaps most remarkable of all, the firewood to cook it upon. I was extremely eager to see this mass of physical evidence, but to begin, I was handed the team's drawings of the reconstructed galley. "Oh, it's got a flue," I exclaimed. I was quite surprised by this development. All of my previous work had indicated that flues and chimneys were rarely introduced into ovens, kilns, furnaces and other enclosed fireboxes when wood was burnt. Practical experience had shown me flues and chimneys were, in most cases, not only unnecessary but actively counterproductive, as, along with the smoke, they channeled all of the heat up and away from where it was wanted. I wanted to see the photos of the underwater excavation site to get a sense for the dimensions and shape of these remarkable survivals. What was special about shipboard conditions, I wondered, that made a flue desirable? The answer, it turned out, was nothing. The reconstruction team had simply assumed there must have been a flue. Since there was no sign of any metal or brick cowling or chimney, they guessed a vent had been situated at the top of each cooking structure's brickwork and had not survived the wreck. It was not such a preposterous assumption. Many old ovens and kilns had flues, but these ovens and kilns dated to the 19th and 20th centuries, and they had burnt coal, not wood. Over a series of visits, I was able to demonstrate how the fuel, fire, and structure worked, both with the contentious flue in place and with it sealed up. When we filled a cauldron with water and lit a fire within the furnace with the flue in place, the experience was dismal. 4.5 hours of vigorous flame barely brought the pot of water to a simmer. Meanwhile, the air temperature around the vent was scorchingly hot, too hot, in fact, for our thermometer to register. We were past the top of the scale after 15 minutes. When we blocked up the flue, the same volume of water was brought to the boil very much faster, in just 45 minutes in one run-through, where the wood was well dried out, and we covered the pot with a wooden lid. When the flue was blocked, the fire's smoke and heat had to exit the cooking structure through the opening at the front. Here, temperatures hovered around 200 degrees to 250 degrees centigrade, but the heat was centred in a small sphere of about 6 inches, 15 centimetres, in diameter. The air rapidly cooled to 150 degrees centigrade within 12 inches, 30 centimetres, of the opening, and to about 80 degrees centigrade at ceiling height. The physics is fairly straightforward. A flue creates a through draft, which draws a large percentage of the heat up. Keeping that heat contained within a narrow channel maintains the high temperature of the exhaust gases. An oven-shaped space in which gases enter and exit by a single opening at the side has a much slower flow of air and smoke. More of the heat generated by combustion is trapped within the chamber, and the exhaust gases, when they do exit, having a wider escape route, dissipate their heat much more quickly. Flues of any sort were rare before coal became our preferred fuel. Putting the Mary Rose's galley to use allowed us to make other unexpected discoveries. During one public demonstration, a member of the archaeological team approached to ask about a pell, a sort of flat wooden shovel, that I and some friends were using to pop a loaf of bread into the ship's reconstructed firebox. Though the galley was not primarily designed for baking, we were explaining how it could have been pressed into action to fulfil this function on a small scale, perhaps when the ship was at anchor and the captain was entertaining. "I've just catalogued something very like that as an oar," confessed the archaeologist. "I wondered what it was doing at the bottom of the ship, next to the galley." There is, of course, no way of being sure something very like that was used as either an oar or a pell, or perhaps pressed into service for both purposes, depending on the demands of any given day. But such practical experience helps to open up the way we look at what the past has left behind for us. Whether by putting the Mary Rose's galley to use, or by stoking a Victorian-era oven, or popping a loaf of bread into a Tudor warship's firebox, I have gathered a great deal of practical experience in history as it was lived, and so I come to the subject of coal in the home from a very different angle to those who have studied the history of coal mining and production, or the history of the home in Britain. I started with a different set of questions and found beguiling new answers. What I stumbled across is a quiet change in the way life was lived, a change that has had a profound effect upon history and continues to have relevance to this day. When we look more deeply and carefully, we can see the many traces and scars of the momentous change to burning coal in the home. Introduction. The Big Switch. When Queen Elizabeth came to the throne in 1558, England and Wales were wood-burning nations. Scotland and Ireland used considerably more peat, the compacted, partly decayed plant matter collected across the bogs. But wood fuel also prevailed in both places, and fuel consumption followed much the same pattern around the rest of the globe. To keep warm and cook our food, people burnt wood. By 1603, London's air had acquired a sulphurous tang, coal's calling card. Coal smoke and fumes were already caught in the basin of the River Thames, hanging over the city in the smog which has distinguished the metropolis for much of its recorded history. This gathering smog signified the start of something completely new and unexpected – the big switch in people's fuel consumption. For millennia, the vast majority of the energy people harnessed was derived from short-term, renewable plant-based sources, such as trees, bushes and scrubs, with reeds and grasses, or dung from plant-eating animals, being pressed into service here and there. These were occasionally supplemented, on a much smaller scale, by the medium-term stored energy of peat. It was a way of living that the historical demographer Edward Anthony Wrigley called an organic economy. People were reliant upon the vegetation that grew around them for their fuel, just as they were reliant upon it to feed them and their livestock. If you wanted more fuel, you needed more land for plants to grow upon, or you needed to increase the efficiency of the system, focusing more intensely upon those species that suited your needs most closely. When Elizabeth died in 1603, that way of living largely held, except for in her capital. London had changed. Alone among population concentrations outside of Asia, this city of just over 200,000 people had chosen to be fired by coal, becoming the first in the Western world to make the big switch. London was making use of a long-term stored energy, an energy source that was not produced on the Earth's surface, competing with growing space for food, but instead stored mostly underground. More coal did not require more land be given over to fuel production, and the coal reserves were vast, at least to the eyes of Elizabethan Londoners, for whom coal quickly morphed from a novel, cheap fuel option into a daily necessity, taken for granted. That coal began its takeover bid in London rather than the industrial centres of the day is significant and often overlooked. At the turn of the 17th century, there were several cities worldwide with bigger populations and many places with more advanced technology. London did have some manufacturing, but Britain's major industry and export earner was then cloth, which, although it was often traded through the Port of London, was made elsewhere. The country's iron industry was concentrated around the Weald in southern England, but coal and iron would not form their powerful partnership for another century. The great northern industrial powerhouses that came to dominate the 18th century were notably absent. London's brewing industry was the largest in Europe, but the demand for beer alone was not enough to explain the large-scale adoption of coal that was happening. Indeed, London and Britain in general were considered by many to be a rather backward place. Much of the country's iron was imported from Sweden, and blast furnace technology had only recently arrived from Europe. When it came to metallurgy of any sort, Britons lacked the knowledge and the skills abundant in other parts of the world. Their reputation was not much better in other areas. Glassmaking was stalled in medieval practice until a group of artisans from Lorraine brought modern methods to Britain. It took an influx of weavers from the Low Countries to revitalise a stagnating cloth industry. William M. Cavett, having studied the city's use of coal in The Smoke of London, came to the conclusion that in 1600 it is unlikely that manufacturing industries exceeded 25% of London's coal demand. The early rise of coal is not a story about industry. It is a tale of domestic needs and comforts, of individual, private choices. London had become a city of small home coal fires, sending up thin plumes of smoke to join the communal smog. Household after household had shifted from wood to coal, outstripping commercial usage three times over. And the change came fast. In 1570, there was still little sign of any major divergence from the traditional use of wood as fuel. Less than 40 years later, in 1607, a case brought by the Crown in the Star Chamber stated as fact that sea coal, a name for the coal that arrived in London by ship from Newcastle, was the ordinary and usual fuel almost everywhere in every man's house. A single generation had made the switch. This shift from heating homes and cooking food with wood to doing so with coal was pivotal in the beginnings of the great transformation that is known as the Industrial Revolution. The leading experts on the history of the coal industry, John Ulrich Neff and John Hatcher, were convinced that the domestic expansion of coal use in the Elizabethan period helped spur the country's mining industry and the later adoption of coal as the fuel of manufacturing, which transformed first Britain and then the world. Yet most of the academic focus has remained on industrial coal use in the 17th and 18th centuries. There are plenty of excellent and interesting publications documenting the switch to coal in the early salt industry, glassmaking and commercial beer breweries, or describing the experiments with coal in the nascent iron industry. The domestic switch, despite its much greater size, greater spread and earlier date, is practically skipped over in the eager rush to get to the, perhaps more manly, industrial stuff. But it is in the home that change really first took hold. Traditionally, we have looked for the great tides of history within the worlds of military conflict, political manoeuvrings, and industrial progress. The home and changes within it have been viewed as matters primarily of interest to women, and as being only of the most mundane interest even to them. When the change from wood to coal was occurring, the chroniclers of the day wrote primarily about battles and speeches and inventions, and in the main they wrote from a very masculine point of view, for their fellows. To comment on domestic matters elicited much less, if any, social cachet, so fewer people did it, and when they did venture into the subjects of hearth and home, they did so in far less detail. Further, coal within the home was handled primarily by decidedly non-elite women. Those who carried the buckets and coal scuttles, cleared out the ashes, scrubbed away the smuts, cooked the meals and boiled the water for the laundry, were wives, mothers and daughters who did not have the resources to call on outside help, or they were the maids and servant girls working in someone else's house. These women commanded the smallest of financial purses, so rarely purchased published texts, and provided scant market for the printed word. Of all groups within society, they were also the least likely to receive a formal education, and were very rarely given the opportunity to publish writing themselves. The male elite of the day generally gave little weight to the experiences, opinions, or insights of working-class wives and servants. Changes within these women's worlds, no matter how dramatic, passed almost unnoticed by those writing for posterity. Very ordinary people, perhaps primarily poor people, in the later years of Elizabeth's reign, made the big switch and set the path for our future. The choices they made set off a chain reaction that encouraged their children and grandchildren to follow the same path, for neighbours to join them, and for Londoners' habits to spread across the country and eventually beyond Britain's shores. Their choices remade the countryside, as fens were drained and woodlands reduced in favour of cropland, and they gave birth to a full-fledged coal trade, establishing new transport networks and fueling generations of commercial and industrial pioneers in the process. And these ordinary Londoners' use of coal developed markets for new products specifically tailored to a life fired by coal. Within the home, coal came to shape a new way of life with new ways of doing things. Having personally experienced the running of domestic spaces, using wood, following the old practices, and using coal with its newfound solutions, I can attest to the fundamental differences between the two ways of coping with everyday situations. the world of the home and hearth was forced to undergo a complete transformation between 1600 and 1800 as the demands of coal were bowed to. Cooking techniques had to change, and so too did cooking tools and utensils. Coal encouraged the rise of certain styles of food and discouraged others, influencing the foods that are eaten as well as how they are prepared. But it was not just in the kitchen that coal had a powerful influence. As coal took over from wood, it forced a change in housework and laundry. Coal fires robbed people of their traditional cleaning agents and introduced a tricky new form of filth. Together, these created a powerful demand for a soap industry. Novel methods of cleaning up were then exported around the globe with Britain's colonial incursions. So complete and thorough was the transformation in British household management practice that even where coal was not the dominant fuel, domestic coal methods, standards, and thinking were often imposed, including in wood-burning households from South Africa to the Indian subcontinent. A seemingly mundane domestic decision about how people heated their homes and cooked their food had profound consequences. It became the foundation of the modern economy, altering the landscape, promoting the rise of global industries, and shaping cultures. It was clearly one of the factors that made the Industrial Revolution possible. Why did these people at this time choose to make a big switch, and why did it prove to be such a permanent and influential move? What impacts did the switch have upon daily life, and how did these impacts ensure the change from wood to coal was more than just a passing phase? Was this domestic matter really all that important? 1. Living off the land. The green and pleasant landscape of modern Britain has been crafted, moulded, and sculpted by successive generations seeking to make a living. And for millennia, a significant part of the pressure upon the land has been people's need for fuel. Competing with the need for the arable land on which crops are grown and the pasture land by which livestock are fed was the need for combustible plant material with which to cook food, brew beer, and stave off the winter chill. People had to make choices: harvest peat or firewood, or harvest food. Over time, they found a variety of ways to combine land uses to maximize the yields of each of these essential components of life. Britain has long been an extensively populated set of islands. The degree of population pressure on the land has fluctuated as different peoples have arrived, moved around, and departed. Famine, plague, and war have each taken their toll, but these were followed by periods of quiet prosperity when numbers have risen again. When Britain's population fell, fields that had been left to revert to scrub grew into woodland. When there were more mouths to feed, areas of marsh were drained to create needed pasture. Sometimes fuel was abundant and gathered rather casually. At other times it was scarce and carefully managed. These changing needs have been etched onto the landscape. The big shift in how Britain's homes were fueled also played out in the surrounding woods, fields, moors, fens, and heaths. So what was the old order? What fuel was used to cook porridge, roast beef, bake pies, dry out sodden socks and warm toes before the advent of coal? Choosing what to burn. It helps to begin with an understanding of how to make a fire. Different fuels burn in different ways, producing not just varying levels of heat, but a range of forms and shapes of it. Some fires release their energy in short, concentrated bursts. Others do so over a longer, slower period. Flames from a coal fire tend to be small and uniform. Peat rarely produces any recognisable flame, instead burning with a hot, smouldering glow, while a bundle of dry twigs can generate long, lazy tongues of wavering flame. But much depends on exactly what you're burning. turves, which are cut from the very top layer of a peat deposit, where plants are still growing, can behave quite unlike each other if they have been harvested from different areas, even when they were taken from the same moorland. Rye straw and barley straw have their own idiosyncrasies, quite distinct from those of wheat. Oak and pine are as different to burn as chalk and cheese. A hard black Welsh anthracite, or stone coal, from Pembrokeshire, combusts in a markedly different way from a softer, tarry, more bituminous sample extracted from the rocks around Newcastle. Fuel can be treated in a number of ways to alter its nature and behaviour within the fire. Unit size is of particular importance. Small chopped sticks burn differently to whole logs. Coal dust and large lump coal are poles apart. For some fuels, orientation is crucial. A bundle of neatly aligned straw, bound a couple of times along its length, can sustain a concentrated flame, where a similar amount of loose, jumbled material would flash and dissipate into ash and dust and unburnt residue in no time. Drying is particularly important for peat, which can easily contain 75% water when first cut, but even anthracite coal burns better if it has had time out of the rain, and there are a whole host of controlled heating and burning processes that can turn fuels into more efficient versions of themselves. Wood can be transformed into white coal, or kiln-dried wood, or, continuing the metamorphosis, into charcoal, where the wood has been charred in an oxygen-depleted environment, driving out all moisture and impurities. Coal, too, can be cooked, or coked, into coke, where once again controlled burning removes unwanted matter, leaving behind a purer, hotter burning fuel. The permutations are almost endless, a fact that allows us humans to use fire in a myriad of ways to achieve a large range of effects. The blacksmith's forge offers an ideal demonstration of the possibilities. Working with coal, for example, you can create a fairly shallow fire, packed down flat on top, which is suitable for tempering or hardening a blade. In contrast, welding, or joining two pieces of metal together, demands a deep and narrow fire. For the highest heats, you can pack the right sort of coal, a rock that is bituminous but low in sulphur and phosphorus, into such a shape that it becomes a virtual oven. The fire can be practically contained within this globe of unburnt fuel, which retains most of the heat rather than allowing it to escape upwards with waste gases, otherwise known as smoke. Sometimes, and rather counterintuitively, mixing a little water with small pieces of coal can help to produce this globe of intense heat by allowing the coal to bind together and form a shell around the fire. This is one way in which coal is coked. By gradually moving the coked material towards the centre of the fire and replacing it with new coal, you increase the efficiency and heat at the centre and open up space around the periphery to turn more coal into coke. We can see this knowledge about forging with coal being committed to print as early as 1677 in Joseph Moxon's Mechanic Exercises. Moxon finished his opening piece on smithing by declaring that he won't bother to describe lighting and using a smith's fire, as the technique is too basic to bother with. He does, however, provide a few tips. You must, with the slice, clap the coals upon the outside, close together to keep the heat in the body of the fire. And as oft as you find the fire begin to break out, clap them close again, and with the washer dipped in water, wet the outside of the fire to damp the outside, as well as to save coals, as to strike the force of the fire to the inside, that your work may heat the sooner. Undoubtedly, smiths had been employing these techniques long before Moxon set them down for publication. Fire management is not just about producing a particular temperature. The size of the physical space held at that temperature is also important and adjustable. If a smith is working on a nail, then a single, small point of high heat is sufficient. Some work, however, requires heat to be diffused across a much larger area, and although iron will conduct heat along its length, raising the temperature of an entire area rather than overheating a single point is generally preferable. Gradations of heat within the same fire can also be useful in allowing a smith to move swiftly from one operation to another, from large to small work and back again. With skill and knowledge, a fire can be used to shape and bend metal, temper and adjust its hardness, brittleness or spring, divide it or unite disparate pieces. When we turn our attention from the forge to the kitchen, we can see a similar range of options and subtleties at play. Managing the fire in your hearth gave you the power to render foodstuffs digestible, transform liquids into bacteria-free drink, conjure cleanliness out of filth, and drive away the chill of northern climes. And just as with the blacksmith's work, different fuels could be brought into service to perform different functions by dint of the techniques and equipment particular to them. It is possible to boil a kettle upon wood, peat, heather, ling, gorse, dried dung, and various types of straw, if you are in possession of the right know-how, but each of these materials are just better suited to some jobs than to others. For instance, dry thistle stalk combusts well because the seed heads, if they have not blown away in the wind, are packed with oil. They are an excellent form of kindling, and many people in England, Wales, Scotland, and Ireland have collected them for this purpose. Yet when Humphrey O'Sullivan watched the women of Callan in County Kilkenny, Ireland, cut old thistle stalks at the end of 1828 for use as winter fuel, he was struck by the unusual scale of their endeavour, with a bundle or load of them on a poor woman as big as a pigsty. He was witnessing an activity born of desperation and resourcefulness, not of preference. That's because, as a fuel to boil a kettle or cook a potato, thistle stalks have many drawbacks. Like all the straws, they burn very fast. Hollow stems direct air to the centre of the conflagration, the long, thin proportions producing a rapid draft, not only encouraging impressive flames, but blowing ash, burning fragments and loose, unburnt material up and away from the fire. Naturally, this process goes even faster if the stems are standing vertically or placed at a rising angle. Capturing heat from this quick energy release can be tricky, but both fuel and hearth can be adapted to fit this purpose. If the stalks are first formed into a set of straight, uniform bundles and securely bound, they can then be stacked and placed under a weight. This crushes the hollow stems flat, thus reducing the airflow capacity through them and slowing down the rate of their burn. It also makes the fire easier to handle and reduces the stoking rate. Ideally, you would burn material like thistle inside a firebox, where the volatile mixture of gases, ash, cinders, and unburnt material can be contained and, hopefully, burnt again later, unlocking more of the thistle's energy. If you didn't have a purpose-built firebox, and it is highly unlikely any of those women in Callan did, a crude version could be rigged up with a horseshoe-shaped arrangement of stones upon a flat hearth, with a cooking pot balanced on top to form a lid. However, you can't leave the thistles for a moment. They burn quite quickly and continuous stoking is required. Indeed, a huge pile of prepared stalks would be needed to bring just one small pot of water to the boil. Anyone reliant upon thistle fuel will eat only the occasional hot meal and live in an almost completely unheated home, which is why the women of Callan must have been very desperate. The commoner's fuel. Dung, particularly cattle dung, was pressed into service in parts of Britain where other sources of fuel were scarce, right up until the widespread adoption of coal for domestic use. It was often used by poorer members of rural communities who had commoners' rights upon areas of rough grazing. Common land was, and is, not public land, nor was it free land for anyone to use as they wished. It was an area held in common by a specific group of people who were permitted to use it in carefully specified ways. In most cases, commoners were the people who rented parcels of land fringing the common. They held the right to graze an agreed number of animals upon the common, as well as the right to collect dead vegetation and other resources, including cowpats, from the land. To be used as a fuel, the dung first had to be dried out. Celia Fiennes, the traveller and memoirist, recorded seeing this in action in 1698 outside the town of Peterborough, where she noticed cow dung upon the walls of the ordinary people's houses and walls of their outhouses. She noted that the dung had been plastered up to dry in cakes which they use for firing. Her visit to Leicestershire revealed the practice in operation there too. She didn't approve in either location. Around the same time, George Meryton published a Yorkshire dialogue which contained a short scene where a mother asks her daughter to fetch some dried cow dung fuel. "Caught some cassins out at Thurn," the mother said, cassins being one of the many regional names for this form of fuel. In Buckinghamshire, they were traditionally called clats, and in Cornwall, glaws. The custom of burning cassins in this part of the country was captured in the probate inventories of the parish of North Cave in the East Riding of Yorkshire from the mid-16th to the mid-17th centuries. This period is not particularly special. It is just that the surviving inventories are from this time, and there is no reason to believe things changed quickly before then or after. In a scattering of the inventories of both the poorer parishioners and the better off, the stocks of cassins on hand when the head of household died were recorded. For example, Richard Brigham, who died in 1626, was neither wealthy nor destitute. He called himself a husbandman, a title which indicated he was farming on a modest scale. He lived in a house with three rooms, many of his neighbours had only one, and among a mix of livestock he had five mares, two colts, two foals, and an old nag, a few cows and 50 pigs, plus a similar number of sheep. His will was written in October, a time of year when most people would have been laying up fuel stores for the winter, and included helm balks, meaning bog oak or old stumps and logs preserved within peat, as well as the other old wood and turfs and cassons. Thomas Clark, who died in 1607, had a two-room house and a slightly smaller accumulation of livestock. His backer end, or outbuildings, contained cassons, turves, and certain old wood. Thomas Pinder was just a touch less prosperous than these men, though he still had a two-room house, which he too kept stocked with turves and cassons. None of these men would have been designated as one of the poor by their contemporaries. They were almost certainly commoners, fitting Celia Fiennes's description of the ordinary people. Their use of cow dung as a fuel may have represented a mixture of tradition and thrift. Other inventories in the same collection, 43 in total, referred to the dung and manure. These words described the same resource, cattle dung, but indicated a different use. Cassons were individually dried out for fuel, while manure was left wet and gathered into heaps where it could break down, ready for use as a fertiliser. Rather surprisingly, the local vicar, Thomas Brabes, headed one of the eight households in 1638 that had cassons in their inventory. He was most assuredly one of the better-off members of his community. Among his wealth in the probate records, 6 rooms were mentioned, as well as such refinements as his library. He also had a load of manure, a rare example of caissons and manure listed side by side. Most people used the dung of their cattle for either fuel or fertilizer. Few had enough of this material to use it for both. The people of the parish of North Cave were exercising a choice as to whether to use the dung of their livestock as fertilizer or fuel, and in at least one sacred case, a bit of both. Dung is a rather curious fuel, in part because it is now a fuel we generally see only among traditional rural populations in hot and remote places. It is also a fuel that can initially be hard for people today to understand, because much of the dung produced by modern farming methods is rather unsuitable for stoking a fire. We are accustomed to dung that is wetter, darker coloured, and much more smelly than the dung Richard Brigham and the other residents of the parish of North Cave would have encountered back in 1620. Modern cattle feed is designed to pack in nutrients in order to produce high milk yields in dairy cows and rapid muscle growth in beef cattle. This super-rich diet has an effect upon the animal's digestive processes. It is in the 21st century a common sight to see cows with their own dung splashing down their legs. They live their lives with something akin to permanent diarrhea. Brigham's cows, and those of his neighbours, had to make do with a high-fibre diet rather than a high-nutrient one. Winter feed in particular was poor. Hay, comprised of dried grass and meadow plants, including their nutrient-packed seed heads, was largely reserved for draft animals who needed energy to work. The rest of the livestock typically ate straw, which was much less nutritious, consisting of the dried stems left over from a wheat, barley or rye crop after the grain had been harvested. In some areas where straw was in short supply, overwintering cattle were reliant upon holly branches cut especially as fodder. Their dung was much drier, more fibrous, paler and far more solid than that of a modern cow. A pat could be picked up after a day or two in the field and would hold together. Judging the right moment for gathering one before sticking it to the wall of an outbuilding to dry probably took a little experience, as a pat would need to be dry enough to handle but sticky enough to adhere to the wall. Leaving pats out in the field too long risks getting them trampled on, reduced to mush and crumble. Once properly dry, the dung could be stacked fairly easily until needed. Personally, I don't have a great deal of experience burning dung. I have never tried to burn cow dung, though I have idly messed about with dried sheep dung. I was bored when camping. In my very limited experience, it catches easily and smoulders along with little difficulty in a rather hot fashion, but it is often smothered by its own ash, which clings around the burning core and has a distinctly pungent and acidic aroma. You could definitely rustle up a supper on it if you needed to, although I would advise keeping a firm lid on any pot to stop the smell infecting the flavour of your meal. In 19th century America, a similar resource, the dried dung of wild buffalo herds, also known as buffalo chips, was an essential fuel for those heading out across the Great Plains. Frederick Piercy, an artist from Liverpool who accompanied a group of pioneers heading to the west, said the chips were composed of grass masticated and digested and dried in the sun. In his illustrated travelogue, The Route from Liverpool to Great Salt Lake Valley, published in parts between 1853 and 1855, he observed, "It is a common joke on the plains that a steak cooked on these chips needs no pepper." According to Derek E. Earle in his book, Forest Energy and Economic Development, dried dung releases about the same amount of energy as peat, a little more than wood does, and more than half of the energy produced by a similar weight of bituminous coal. And, of course, it is typically there for the taking. Of peat and turves. If some of the good people of North Cave knew much more than me about the use of caissons in the home, far more were expert in the use of peat and turves. Rather confusingly, peat and turf are sometimes used interchangeably, especially in Ireland. There are more than four times the number of listings of turves than of caissons in the North Cave probate inventories, plus another handful of households that mention turf spades, but no turves. This parish included a section of the Wallingfen, a wet and boggy area of thin peat, moss and patches of reed and thin grasses, for which many parishioners had commoners' rights. These commons, as we have noted, were not a free-for-all, and turf cutting was highly regulated. On St. Helen's Eve, the 3rd of May, each attested commoner was permitted to stake a claim for the coming turf-cutting season, so long as he, or she, if she were a widow, did so before noon. Once claimed, the turf was permitted to be cut only during the hours of daylight and only until Midsummer's Day, towards the end of June. No fuel obtained from the fen was to be sold to anyone outside the jurisdiction of the Liberties, which included all of the parishes that had a share of the land. The season's cutting was further restricted, in an attempt to preserve supplies for the future, to a single turf spades deep, in this region about 12 inches, 30 centimetres deep. No one knows when people started cutting peat for fuel. We are equally in the dark about when people began to manage this resource in such an orderly manner. Besides extracting peat, the fens could be used in a variety of ways, as grazing for all sorts of livestock, for haymaking, for fishing and fowling, or for the gathering of sedge and reeds for thatch, and of sallows for basket making. Since digging the place up to get the peat out destroys the potential for most of these other uses, peat cutting was restricted. The best known of the old peat-cutting areas in England today are the Norfolk Broads. Leases for areas of Turbury, the local name for fenland, set aside for peat-cutting, indicate that people were cutting peat in the Broads in a regulated fashion by 1140. Between the Norman Conquest in 1066 and the arrival of the Black Death in 1348, the population of the British Isles had risen from under 2 million people to around 4.5 million. Pressure on basic resources was acute. Marginal areas of land were brought into cultivation despite dreadfully poor yields. Peat digging was confined to small linear plots, so the cuttings were pushed deeper and deeper to extract much-needed fuel. Modern practice, continuing commercially right up until the Second World War, and a few walls of earth surviving from the medieval broads, the open areas of fresh water created by peat diggings, suggest that each small pit was the result of a single season's campaign by a single digger, perhaps with the help of his family. Looking at the accounts of those involved in the last days of commercial hand-cut peat, we can piece together an understanding of the methods that left behind these traces in the shape of the earth and water bodies. Mad Jack Darnell was a peat-cutter. In the late spring of 1892, he was kind enough to demonstrate his traditional method of turf cutting for the photographer, P.J. Deacon, and these images, along with memories of people who knew Mad Jack or themselves worked in the peat business, were collected in 1999 by Anthony Day, the nephew of the last commercial peat cutter in the area of Wicken Fen in Cambridgeshire, in his book Fuel from the Fens. During winter, Wicken Fen is very wet. The water table sits not far below the surface, and the waterlogged peat can freeze solid in the cold weather. Mad Jack's work, therefore, began in March, when the peat slowly began to thaw and dry, and finished in late August. With a piece of string stretched between two pegs thrust into the ground, he'd mark out a straight line parallel to pits he or others had worked in previous seasons. This new work area was not directly on the side of the old digging, because these diggings had filled with water over the winter. Instead, a strip was left untouched to act as a bulk, or wall, between the old, now flooded pit, and the new. This had the advantage of leaving Mad Jack room to stack drying turves along the edge of the pit on one side and still have space to run a barrow up and down the length of his workings. The surface vegetation was stripped off, leaving a bare and flat surface into which the new season's hole was dug. First, an edge was cut into the peat with a turf knife, and then the real work began. Cutting into peat requires strength and perseverance. Water slowly seeps from the surrounding bog through the top section of peat, forcing diggers to stop and bail out water on occasion. Peat cutters tried to maintain a relatively standard block size, since this helped in monitoring how the blocks were drying. Extraordinarily straight and even, and about the size of a modern breeze block when first dug, each block of peat was stacked one atop another at the edge of the digging so that it could begin drying as soon as possible. The peat blocks had to be moved and restacked in different formations several times as they dried to permit the sun and wind to do their work. In an essay published by the Highland Society of Scotland in 1803, the Reverend Dr. John Walker noted, "The floor or surface peat affords but a very weak fire, like a parcel of dry sticks or straws, and leaves as few ashes behind. The heather peat and the springy brown peat, formed by the decay of herbaceous plants, are somewhat better, being a little more lasting. But the solid black peat, formed from wood and which lies deep, is much preferable to these and makes the best fuel." While his understandings of the origins of the different types of peat would today be refuted scientifically, Professor Walker's observations about the burning characteristics of peat taken from different depths is sound. Deep, highly compressed peat burns much more steadily and for a longer period. The processes by which vegetation turns into peat have simply had longer to act, so the peat has a much more even texture and is less likely to contain intact stems or roots. The other reason to dig deep is a desire to maximize upon one's investment. Given how much better it performed, it is quite likely that deeper peat fetched a higher price at market. Some areas of the fen were subject to common rights, but some areas could be leased, with fewer restrictions on where the peat was sold. Regardless, the surface areas claimed for cutting could be quite small. The deeper you dug, the more peat, and potentially profit, you could extract from your section. Such diggings left behind a landscape of multiple small deep pools divided by walls of untouched peat. From the early 15th century onwards, we have evidence of some secondary rounds of peat extraction conducted by cutting into these walls sometime after the initial digging. The method did not survive in England, but something rather like it did continue in the Netherlands into the 19th century, when it attracted antiquarian and folklorist interest, and in Ireland, in areas where the bog is especially wet. Evidence of the practice in England comes in the main from a set of accounts kept by the owners of Bartonbury Hall in Norfolk. In 1451, for example, a profit of 10 shillings and no pence for 12 lasts of fen taken in the several pond waters of the Lord with lagging was recorded. Another entry mentioned the peat had been retrieved with a dide, a tool identified through the writings of farmer-poet Thomas Tusser more than a century later, when he advised using one to clear out ditches in winter. Several of Bartonbury's accounting entries also make it clear that the estate's peat had not been cut in nice organised blocks, as it was sufficient for making 4,000 turves. Instead, it is likely some balks were hacked away, with the loose peat being dredged out of the water with the dye-day. This wet, broken peaty mass then had to be dried out and pressed into turves. In Ireland, Humphrey O'Sullivan described similar peat pulp, which, he said, had been kneaded by human feet and then made into briquettes by women's hands. And lo, bit by bit, the several pond waters became abroad, as all the little peat divisions were removed. A fire of smoke and spirit. Using peat as a fuel is a varied business. As Professor Walker pointed out at the beginning of the 19th century, its burning quality can vary quite a lot, depending on where it comes from. In addition, the structure of the peat block, or turf, was determined by the method of extraction. Turves cut with a spade or other hand tool have a grain representing the horizontal layers of year after year of material deposition. The grain is most obvious in mid-level peat, where the plant material has had time to begin to break up and been subject to a fair amount of pressure squeezing down upon it. Surface peat, which has not been subject to so much decomposition or pressure, retains more of the chaotic texture of intertwined stems and roots. Peat, dug from deep layers, has a grain that is finer, more densely packed, and harder to discern. It becomes more obvious during combustion, when the ash maintains the structure of the block until it is disturbed and falls away into a soft, fine powder. Peat that has been dredged up out of the bog water and reformed into briquettes has no structure whatsoever. If there is a grain in the peat, the blocks tend to burn along it. Since peat is what might be called a contact burner, fire spreads through direct contact, the grain makes a difference. Reformed briquettes create a sphere or hemisphere of fire, since the initial spark catches on the outside surface and works its way steadily inwards. The fire in its early stages, therefore, remains largely within the block, with the surrounding unburnt peat serving as something of an insulation. Hand-cut peat, with its grain running across the original deposit lines of plant fibres, helps to direct the spread of your fire, as it is more likely to ignite the peat within the same deposit layer rather than the peat in the layers above and below. A plate of fire is formed. This fire tends to burn to the edges of the block, where it is exposed to the air, releasing heat in a usable fashion. Once your fire has a good hold, which can take a considerable time with this slow-burning fuel, the burning peat starts to resemble charcoal. It is at this stage that it can successfully be used for cooking or heating water. You will not see any flames, and the heat dissipates very quickly if you move your pot away from the direct contact with the fire. So while a pot can be suspended above a peat fire, it needs to be close. Actual boiling is best done with the pot sides touching burning turves. If it is moved just a couple of centimetres further away, bringing a pot to the boil is almost impossible. Maintaining a simmer is generally the best you might do. The high heat required for baking can be achieved by laying food upon some hot stone or iron surface in the centre of a peat fire, upturning a pot over the food and heaping burning turves around and on top of the pot. However, the need for such close contact places a significant limit on how many cooking vessels can be put into use at any one time. There are two things that people particularly like about peat as a fuel: the smell and the staying power. Peat smoke has a strong, distinctive smell, one that evokes powerful memories of home, especially for those who have moved away from peat-burning districts. Peat smoke translates into flavour wherever it comes into contact with food, particularly dairy produce or other animal fats, and whiskey, of course. The smell is a product of chemicals from the peat's original plant materials, but its prevalence is mostly a function of the slow, cool-burning nature of a peat fire. Whatever calorific value is locked up within the material is released only slowly and at a considerably lower temperature than that of wood, straw, or coal. The low temperature of combustion creates a great deal of partly burnt particles that we experience as smoke. In fact, the sheer abundance of fine particulates released by peat makes it one of the most damaging of all fuels for the lungs. Staying power, unsurprisingly, is also a result of the cool-burning nature of peat. A single turf can burn for over an hour, which means a peat fire requires very little attention, not a small consideration for anyone running a busy household. The loss of wetlands. Generally, the presence of peat in an area indicated a shortage of wood. Wet, boggy areas are not ideal for most tree growth. It works the other way round too. Where the land is very wet, felling trees that once sucked up excess water can make an area even more boggy, creating an accumulation of peat where once a straggly wood grew. Before coal, there were very many more peaty areas than there are today. Once usable coal supplies became widely available, fewer people were reliant upon peat. The ability and demand to put more land into agricultural production meant many wet areas were rapidly drained. The largest area that is still called the Fens, nearly 2.485 square miles, 4,000 square kilometres, in Lincolnshire, Cambridgeshire and Norfolk, is today prime cropland with only tattered fragments of wetland and peat formation surviving. But while this area is well known, there were once many small pockets of lowland fen scattered about in shallow valleys where drainage was poor and seasonal waterlogging was common. For example, Wallingfen, where the people of North Cave were cutting their turves in the 16th and 17th centuries, is now an area of flat agricultural development dotted with farmsteads, as well as a completely new post-fen settlement called Newport. This township was built at the very end of the 18th century, when, to provide transport and to drain the area, a canal was driven through the local wetlands. Natural England estimates that around three-quarters of England's former fenland is now...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.